something that the Lord has been speaking to me over the weeks. It came out of a burden. It came out of a frustration, actually, because there we are, locked up in in our houses and unable to go out and do anything. We're just supposed to be on freeze mode. So as I was pondering and thinking what we should do when these things are lift off, or how we can help the community, help people around, and there is a lot of people without hope, a lot of people having distress, going through depression and oppression and so on. So I was pondering about that, and I just remembered the Lord showing me in a dream that the stage is taken away. It's as if like everything is stripped away. About three, 4 weeks before we went into full lockdown. And I was pondering about that, and then I came to understanding that every stage of every ministry has been taken off at this time. And that's what the Lord was trying to reveal to me some time back. And when this is done, it is like a time to reflect, why we do things what we are doing. Are we doing it for the things, for the stage, or for a man, or for our ego or our ambition? And this is what the Lord started speaking to me. And in my frustration, when I was pondering that I want to go out and do something, part of the, volunteers or teams, then I came to an understanding at this time, what the Lord wants us to do is stay in prayer. You can't do much, but you can definitely start praying for one another. You can start praying for your country. You can start praying for your village. You can start praying for your community. Think about it. You don't want to start praying after you started to get affected. That'll be too late. But you have to start praying beforehand, before your loved ones get affected, before your community gets affected, before your prime minister or president or whoever who can get affected. Definitely, I'm talking about this virus which is going on. We are there as believers to stand in the gap and pray for these things. But you may say, Lord is sovereign. He knows what is happening, what is going on. Why do we need to pray? Let's watch some TV. Let's watch, do some activity. Fun activity, keep us entertained. But my friends, this time, the stage or the altar is in your private place, in your rooms, in your prayer closet. That's where the altar is. And the Lord is looking for who will stand in the gap. Time and time again, the Lord is sovereign, but He wants us to partner with Him. He waits for His children, His servants to call upon Him, His name, so that He can show Himself strong. Time and time again, we see in the Bible, this is how God works. But there are times He has sovereignly come in and turn things around. But I believe at this hour, at this time, it is our turn for us to go on our knees and begin to stand in the gap and begin to pray. Amen. So we are going to look at a story in the book of Isaiah. If you may turn to the book of Isaiah. So this story is about King Hezekiah. Everyone with me, you have turned your Bibles to Isaiah. Isaiah 36. So this story is a typical scenario. You know, you can call it a prophetic story for times like this, or you can call it, a good example for a time like this. So we are starting in chapter 36. The story is about a king, Hezekiah, king of Jerusalem, and how the Lord raised him up. And here Isaiah has already told the people, you are relying on the wrong source. You're relying on Egypt. And this is going to cause you into trouble. And then we see in the end, King Hezekiah humbles himself before the Lord and he prays for divine deliverance. And the city is miraculously saved by the Lord. Amen. So let's, I told the story before we actually went through it, but this is the essence. But let's have a look at the story, starting from verse 1. Some verses I might just end it shorter than what is in the Bible, so that we can stay focused on the story. Isaiah 36, chapter 36, starting from 1. Now it came to pass in the 14th year of King Hezekiah, the Sennacherib, king of Assyria, came up against all the fortified cities of Judah and took them. So when Hezekiah was king, there were two kingdoms, one of Judah and other one of Jerusalem. And he has already come king of Assyria and taken the kingdom of Judah. And not only kingdom of Judah, he has already taken quite a bit of the area, surrounding kingdoms. Then king of Assyria sent the Rabshakeh with a great army from Lachish to the king Hezekiah at Jerusalem. So this king of Syria sends a messenger to go and deliver a message to King Hezekiah. And he sends him with a great army. Now, it's quite typical, like the scenario at the moment. There is great fear. There is, anxiousness waiting when this virus is going to get us. Anxiety. Then said to them, say now to Hezekiah, thus says the great king, the king of Assyria, what confidence is this in which you trust? So at times like this, you need to ask yourself, what do you trust in? The enemy is asking, what do you trust? Do you trust the NHS, the health service, or the doctors, or the new organization which is called WHO, or what, WHO, or your government, or there are a number of things that you can put your trust in. So when the enemy comes, it's going to ask you, who do you put your trust? And it's a good time to reflect, where is your trust? I say, we are on verse 5. I say, you speak of having plans and power for war, but they are mere words. Now in whom do you trust that you rebel against me? Look, you are trusting in the staff of this broken reed, Egypt, on which if a man leans, it will go into his hand and pierce it. So is Pharaoh, king of Egypt, to all who trust in him. So apparently Jerusalem has put its trust in Egypt. And this enemy is saying, your trust in this Egypt is like a, you know, dried up stick. You know, if you put your hand, it'll go through your hand. You can't even lean on it. That's how bad it is. We are on verse 7. But if you say to me, we trust in the Lord, our God, is it not he whose high places and whose altars Hezekiah has taken away and said to Judah and Jerusalem, you shall worship before this altar? So Hezekiah has done some changes, alteration, where you should worship and so on. So the enemy is now trying to confuse the people. It might be in your situation. Oh, I haven't read the Bible. I haven't prayed enough. Oh, I haven't walked with the Lord. I have fallen short of things of God. I'm upset with someone. I'm angry. No, these are things, you know, it points toward the wrong altar. The enemy will always show things, for you to get confused. Verse 8, now therefore I urge you, give a pledge to my master, the king of Assyria, and I will give you 2,000 horses, if you are able on your part to put riders on them. See how, you know, enemy always wants to take you out in his court, you know, on his battlefield, you know, never, you know, Bible might say, certain things, you know, pray, fast, stand in the gap. But the enemy will take you to a different game altogether and a different field. It's, you know, completely talking about something totally different. I'm going to give you some horses. Are you able to put some men on it? You're not even capable of. See how the enemy is trying to, with the mind, playing. And bringing fear upon the people. How then will you repel one captain of the least of my master's servant and put your trust in Egypt for chariots and horsemen? Have I now come up without the Lord against the land to destroy it? The Lord said to me, go up against this land and destroy it. Can you see this? Now he has changed the whole picture and he's saying, the Lord asked me to go and destroy. So now there might be some people, giving you wrong information that the Lord has decided to destroy the nations. The Lord who took so much care to save his people, do you think he wants to destroy it? The Lord who delights in people getting saved, do you think he wants to destroy those people who are saved? So this is how the enemy changes the story and plays with your mind. Then the Rabshakeh stood and called out with a loud voice in Hebrew and said, "Hear the words of the great king of Assyria." We are on 13. Thus says the king, "Do not let Hezekiah deceive you, for he will not be able to deliver you." Can you see? Now, not only that, the enemy now is playing with people's mind, saying that whoever who is going to lead you to the salvation, to rescue you or deliver you, he don't trust him. Nor let Hezekiah make you trust in the Lord, saying, "The Lord will surely deliver us. This city will be not be given into the hands of King Assyria." Do not listen to Hezekiah, for thus says the king of Assyria, "Make peace with me by a present and come out to me, and every one of you eat from his own wine, and everyone from his own fig tree, and everyone of you drink the waters of his own citron, until I come and take you away to a land like your own land, a land of grain and new wine, a land of bread and vineyards. Beware, lest Hezekiah persuade you, saying, 'The Lord will deliver us.' Has anyone of the gods of the nation delivered its land from the hand of King Assyria?" Now, the enemy is trying to say, "I have destroyed many nations, and those many nations have different gods. Still, they couldn't withstand. Are you saying that your God is going to deliver you?" Doubt after doubt after, you know, building fear. It's typical, similar to our media right now, you know, bringing, you know, we definitely know there is a enemy, there is something, you know, really dangerous, but fear can kill people just by fearing. There are people thinking about suicide. There are people, you know, in depression and oppression. You know, when your immune system, when you go through this, your immune system comes down. See how the enemy is playing this mind battle, the mind game? Where are the gods of Hamath? So he's going on about all these different gods. Where are the gods of Sepharvaim? Indeed, have they delivered Samaria from my hand? Who among the gods of those lands have delivered their countries from my hand, that the Lord should deliver Jerusalem from my hand? But they held their peace and answered him not a word. For king's commandment was, "Do not answer him." They came to Hezekiah with their clothes torn and told him. So Hezekiah has already told them, if this guy comes and talks to you, don't answer him back. We are not in the game. We are not in his battlefield. We are not going to think how he thinks. Once you start answering the way the enemy wants you to answer, you are completely in the wrong battlefield. Because the enemy knows all the right answers for his battlefield. Now we go on to chapter 37, starting from verse 1. And so it was when King Hezekiah heard it, that he tore his clothes, covered himself with sackcloth, and went into the house of the Lord. See what Hezekiah does? Immediately, he doesn't waste the time. He you know, covers him, he clothes himself with sackcloth, humbles himself, goes into the house of the Lord to pray. My friends, to pray. Then he sent some people to Isaiah the prophet, asked Isaiah to lift up your prayer for the remnant that is left. So the servant of King Hezekiah came to Isaiah, and Isaiah said to them, "Thus you shall say to your master, thus says the Lord, do not be afraid of the words which you have heard, with which the servant of the king of Assyria have blasphemed me." So basically, he sends messengers to Isaiah, the prophet, to inquire of the Lord and to, you know, speak to the Lord. Not only is he praying, he gets the prophet to intercede, inquire of the Lord as well. And immediately the word comes to the prophet saying, the Lord says, don't be afraid. These guys have blasphemed me. I will take care of the situation. Amen. So, similarly, I know a lot of people are trusting in the Lord, but at the same time, there is a mocking, there is a laughing, and, you know, that, especially in the media, how they don't know the power of God. They don't understand it, and they start to mock and, start to, say bad stuff about the Lord. Surely I will send a spirit on him, and he shall hear a rumor and return to his own land. And I will cause him to fall by the sword of his own land. So Lord has already declared how this Syrian king, Assyria king, is going to die because of him not respecting the Lord Almighty. He sent messengers to Hezekiah again, saying, thus you shall speak to Hezekiah, the king of Judah. So the Assyrian king is sending again, to bring more fear, saying, do not let your God in whom you trust deceive you, saying, Jerusalem shall not be given into the hand of King Assyria. Now he is directly challenging the Lord Almighty. And he's saying, do not put your trust in that Lord. Look, you have heard what the kings of Assyria have done to all the land, but utterly destroying them. And shall you be delivered? Saying, every nation, everyone is affected. People are dying by the thousands. Are you trying to say things are going to turn around? Have the gods of the nations delivered those whom my fathers have destroyed? Gozan, Haran, Rezpa, and the people of Eden, who were in Telasa. Where is the king of Hamath, the king of Arpad, and the king of the city of Shepravim, Hena and Eva? So he's bringing, just bombarding Hezekiah with all these names, all these kingdoms, all these people that his ancestors have defeated, and he has defeated, and he's just making a mockery out of this. And Hezekiah received the letter from the hand of the messengers and read it, and Hezekiah wept, went up to the house of the Lord. Again, Hezekiah, where does he go? Not to go and get his army ready, but he goes to the house of the Lord for prayer. That's where the real battle is. And spreads it before the Lord. He's as if he's taking like a petition, like a, you know, like a court order or something, you know, to go and put it and say, Lord, you be the judge of this. You know, this is the threat that we are getting. This is the accusation. Friends, we need to start doing this, you know. We need to put everything which is coming, bombarding us, all that fear and all that threat and everything, and put it before the Lord and begin to start praying like Hezekiah is doing. Then Hezekiah prayed to the Lord, saying, O Lord of hosts, God of Israel, the one who dwells between the cherubim, you are God, you alone. So he's declaring he's the one true God. All of the kingdoms of the earth, you have made heaven and earth. You are God over the kingdoms of the earth, and you have made the heaven and the earth. Incline your ear, O Lord, and hear. Open your eyes, O Lord, and see. And hear all the words of Sennacherib, which he has sent to reproach the living God. So he's directly saying to the Lord, look, Lord, you need to take this battle on. They are actually challenging you. Truly, Lord, the king of Assyria have laid waste all the nations and their lands. So he's actually, you know, telling this is the truth. You know, king of Assyria has actually done these things to the other nations, which is true, Lord. And have cast their gods into the fire, for they were not gods. And he's making sure to mention that they are not real gods of those nations. But the works of men's hands, wood and stone, therefore they destroyed them. Now therefore, O Lord God, save us from this hand, that all the kingdoms of the earth may know that you are the Lord, you alone. So Hezekiah is saying, Lord, just do this so that the whole earth, whole world may know that you are the Lord. Amen. The word of the Lord concerning Sennacherib. Then Isaiah the son of Amos sent to Hezekiah saying, so Isaiah has got a download from the Lord, you know, about Hezekiah's prayer, and he gives a word from the Lord. Thus says the Lord God of Israel, because you have prayed to me against Sennacherib, king of Assyria, this is the word which the Lord has spoken concerning him. The virgin daughters of Zion has despised you, laughed you to scorn. The daughter of Jerusalem has shaken her head behind your back, whom you have reproached and blasphemed, against whom you have raised your voice and lifted up your eyes on high, against the holy one of Israel. By your servants you have reproached the Lord and said, by the multitude my chariots I have come up to the heights of the mountains, to the limits of Lebanon. I will cut down its tall cedars and its choice cypress trees. I will enter its furthest heights to its fruitful forest. I have dug and drunk water, and will and with the soles of my feet I have dried up all the brooks of defense. Did you not hear long ago how I made it? Now the Lord is declaring who he is, in case the king of Assyria doesn't know. From ancient times that I formed it, now I have brought it to pass that you should be of crushing fortified city into heaps of ruin. Therefore, their inhabitants had little power. They were dismayed and confounded. They were as grass of the field and a green herb, as the grass on the house step and grain belighted before it is grown. But I know your dwelling. This is like a direct threat. You know, it's like, you know, it's like in the movies, you know, or, you know, when you want to give someone a threat. Verse 28. So, verse 28. But I know your dwelling place. I know where you live. You are going in and you're coming. You're going out and you're coming in. That means I'm watching you. I know everything about you. And your rage against me. And he knows his heart, their heart also. Because you rage against me and your turmoil have come up to my ears. Therefore, I will put my hook in your nose and my bridle in your lips, and I will turn your back by the way which you came. This shall be a sign to you. You shall eat this year such a growth of itself, and the second year what springs from the same, also the third year sow and reap, plant vineyards and eat the fruit of them. The remnant who have escaped the house of Judah shall again take root down and bear fruit upwards. For out of Jerusalem shall go a remnant, and those who escape from Mount Zion, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The zeal of the Lord of hosts is going to do this. The Lord is saying, therefore, thus says the Lord concerning the king of Assyria, he shall not come into this city. That prayer made the Lord declare, the king shall not come into the city, nor shoot an arrow there, nor come before it with a shield, nor build a siege. Siege mount against it. By the way that he came, by the same shall he return, and he shall not come into the city, says the Lord. For I will defend this city, save it for my own sake and for my servant David's sake. See how the Lord replies to that prayer. For that threat the people are bringing, for the enemy is bringing. 36. Then the angel of the Lord went out and killed in the camp of Assyrian 185,000. And when people arose early in the morning, there were corpses all dead. Just one angel. 185,000 dead. Now, the Lord has many angels. Imagine if all of us went on our knees and prayed and asked the Lord for deliverance, asked the Lord to come through. What will the reaction be? It is not too late. It is not hopeless. We are the hope. We are supposed to stand in the gap. Verse 37, I'm ending it now. So Sennacherib, king of Assyria, departed and went away, returned home, and remained in Nineveh. Now it came to pass, as he was worshipping in the house of Nisroch, his god, that his son Adramelech and Sharezer struck him down with a sword, and they escaped into the land of Aratat. Then Esarhaddon, his son, reigned in his place. So can you see, as the Lord has told, as the Lord has prophesied and released the word, the king of Assyria was struck by his own family and he died. My friends, if you want to be a world changer, this is your time. This is your hour. The world changing doesn't happen on a stage. It happens in a prayer closet. As you stay faithful in the prayer closet, in your prayer, and stand in the gap, the Lord will raise you up to a place of influence and power and authority, and bring deliverance for the people of your town, of your city, of your village. Would you take this call on you and begin to stand in the gap?